Everybody, this is Archana here from Read, Write, Inspire Book Club. So today we are discussing The Great Gatsby by Scott Fitzgerald. So let me start the presentation. Okay. So today I thought these are some of the topics that I wanted to discuss about. The jazz age, as the 20s are called. And just a minute, Tulika is here. Hi, Tulika. So the topics we are discussing today are the jazz age, the lost generation, that's the group of writers, we'll see about them. Then young America and old Europe. A lot about Scott Fitzgerald himself as a author and the characters and people around him who inspired Great Gatsby, and some discussions and quotes. Okay. The 20s in America is called as the Roaring 20s. In fact, the term the jazz age was coined by Fitzgerald himself. So this was the age of the rising stock markets, the Wall Street boom, big parties, jazz music, which is why it's called as the jazz age. Loser morals, high-rise buildings, hedonism. So hedonism is where pleasure is the most important thing, and that is the guiding principle of the society. And I think someone is not on mute. Please mute yourself. And then we have prohibition. It was the era of prohibition, which in fact didn't really happen. There was no prohibition. Alcohol was getting sold illegally, which was one of the things that we come to know that Gatsby was doing. He's called as a bootlegger. And this Roaring 20s led to the flapper culture. So this flapper culture is where women wear low skirts and bobbed hair and heavy makeup. So all this is called as the flapper culture. And the Roaring 20s is when all this was happening in the US. And the lost generation are, one second. Okay. So the lost generation are the American expats in Paris. So some of these American expats were these writers like Gertrude Stein, Sylvia Beach, James Joyce, Ezra Pound, William Faulkner, and Ernest Hemingway too, though he was not very well known at that time. And with this group, Fitzgerald was one of the most important part of this group. And just like the writers of today, all these writers were also very well known to each other. And also they were good friends. They went out, had fun. Just a second. I think something is echoing. 1 minute. Yeah. So why did this term lost generation was coined by Gertrude Stein? I hope I'm pronouncing her name right. I'm not sure. And so the reason she felt this was all these writers, what they shared between them was this feeling that there was nothing in the traditions that they had inherited. But at the same time, they did not feel despair that they were lost. It wasn't, it was in fact fashionable to call themselves as this lost generation. It was fashionable to state that they were disillusioned and that, but at the same time, they were filled with a lot of energy and optimism. They felt they could, they had the power to really take on the future and shape it. one more thing among all of them was that they were very dissatisfied with the then narrowness of American civilization. So they preferred to live elsewhere, especially in Paris. In fact, all of them were in Paris. So there was something between young America and old Europe. So the Americans had a immense fascination for Paris, other European cities, and the European culture. And this was the main theme of most of Henry James' novels. Henry James has this famous psychologist brother called William James. And William James also wrote a lot of books related to his field, psychology. So it's in fact popularly said that William James wrote psychology like a novel, and Henry James wrote his novels like psychology, because he did a lot of analysis between what goes on in the mind of Americans when they see Paris and the European cities and the European culture, how much they yearn for that and how much they prefer to live there. So one of the persons in this was Fitzgerald. So before we go further, in these roaring 20s, one of the writers who captured this roaring 20s very beautifully and presented it in a very in a critical and at the same time in a realistic manner was Fitzgerald. So a little bit more about him. So he's known as the cult hero of his time. So he's exactly like the person, like maybe you can say Gatsby is modeled on what Fitzgerald is, you know. So many of the characters whom we see over there is in the novel is exactly how Fitzgerald lived his life. So he temporarily achieved popular success and fortune in the 20s. However, it wasn't very everlasting. You know, he didn't gain so much popularity at that time. Most of the acclaim that reached him was after his death. In fact, decades after his death. So now he's one of the greatest American writers of the 20th century. So I thought it might be interesting to see Fitzgerald through the relationships that he had and how they influenced the writing of Gatsby. So I'm going to just take a little bit of walk through his life through some of the important characters. So the first most important person in his life was Ginevra King. So she was his one true love. However, she was this rich person from a huge high-class society, and he was this poor boy from a low-class society. In fact, her father clearly tells him that poor boys shouldn't think of marrying rich girls. And the entire theme of Great Gatsby is that, you know, it's that money, it's between the new money is very important in society. And even though you may be a newly rich person, you may be rich, but still, if you're a new rich, then you're not equal to the established rich of the high class society. So the whole idea of Gatsby, Fitzgerald later explained, that is the unfairness of a poor young man not being able to marry a girl with money. This theme comes up again and again because I lived it. In fact, when he knew this is not going to work out between him and Ginevra, he falls in love with another person called Zelda. We'll just be seeing her in the next slide. So even when he was in love with Zelda and carrying on with Zelda and all that also, he was still writing letters to Ginevra and asking her to take him back, you know, pleading with her that to once again get back together and all this stuff. But of course, it didn't happen. And only after Ginevra was married that Fitzgerald, in fact, proposes to Zelda. So Zelda is, she is also a rich, ambitious, reckless, and a very extravagant person, a completely unbalanced character. And in fact, after a point of time when, initially she rejects Fitzgerald because he's penniless and he's not any, he doesn't have anything, he's not published anything of value and all that stuff. However, after some time, once he gets published and he has some repute and his short stories also start appearing in magazines, the first novel is released and all that, after that she agrees to marry him. But before that itself, in fact, just before the marriage, there is Fitzgerald tells his friend that I'm no longer in love with Zelda, but I can't stand the idea of her actually marrying somebody else, so I'm going to get married to her. But as a couple, they were this completely wild couple. After marriage, they immediately check into Biltmore Hotel in New York City, and they just like how they show, the characters. I'm hoping many of you got a chance to see the movie Great Gatsby also. So when I read about Zelda and Fitzgerald, it's like as if I'm exactly seeing what I saw in the movies, because it's said that Fitzgerald used to do handstands in the lobby and Zelda used to just zoom down the banisters of the staircase and all these crazy things. In fact, I think it was Dorothy Parker. The first time she meets Fitzgerald was when Fitzgerald and Zelda are on the top of a taxi and riding through town. So this is exactly the kind of people they were. In fact, they were so noisy and so annoying in the hotel that the hotel asked them to leave. Despite being a popular author and other things, they say, "You're disturbing our other guests, so please leave." And then they check into the Concorde and this goes on. So this interesting and extremely, colorful marriage, among this, what happens is Ernest Hemingway and Fitzgerald become very good friends. So Ernest Hemingway, in fact, in his memoir, A Movable Feast, he writes a lot about Fitzgerald and what was his relationship, what were the relationships, what happened. He writes a lot about Zelda also, and it's very clear that he does not like Zelda. In fact, Hemingway claims that Zelda always used to encourage her husband to drink because it would distract him from working on his novel. And she wanted him to just write short stories that he can quickly sell to magazines, and that would help support her lifestyle. And so actually he used to do that. So he used to write a normal short story as in the normal way how he wants it to be written. And then what he would do is he would try and create a completely wild, fanciful ending for the story and then go back and rewrite it according to the fanciful ending. And that used to be making it easier to sell it off, but the literary value of it used to diminish. At least, this was something that Hemingway hated in what this particular thing that Fitzgerald was doing. And this was a sore point between both of them. However, once Hemingway read The Great Gatsby, he was completely blown away. He loved the book and he wanted to help, Fitzgerald to finish the book and publish it, because he was very scared that Zelda would stop him from writing the novel. So against this background, despite all his alcoholism and poor work ethic and everything, his writing was absolutely brilliant. So he's written 4 novels, 4 collections of short stories, and a total of 164 short stories in his lifetime. And as I said, he's considered as the cult hero. He's representative of the men of his age, multiple relationships, careless, immoral, high life, embracing liberalism and all this. In fact, he himself stated this: America is going on the greatest spree in history. That's what he called the jazz age. The biggest challenge he faced as a writer was writing despite Zelda, because Zelda was this completely attention-seeking person who kept doing things to distract him from writing. So he wrote despite her, that's what could be said. And so Fitzgerald calls, this is another interesting thing that he says about the jazz age. So it was an age of miracles. It was an age of art. It was an age of excess. And it was an age of satire. The Great Gatsby is his greatest work. It's based on his own life. It's set on the prosperous Long Island of 1922. he dedicated the book as once again to Zelda, and it was critically acclaimed by many famous writers of that time. Immediately they acclaimed it, but it did not sell much. It sold only a few copies. It was popular only after decades. In fact, he got very meager loyalties from the Great Gatsby. In fact, I think his first loyalty check was for some $5. The second one was for some 30 cents. And the final royalty check he got was for some $13. That's it. That's all he got from the Great Gatsby. Okay, so before we go to the discussion points, maybe I'll stop, share, and tell all of you a hi. Hi, Tulika, and
hi,
others who joined in later.
Yeah, I totally lost track of time today.
I know, and I've changed it from Friday to Thursday. I was thinking, oh, you must have got confused with the dates too.
No, it's good. I got most of it, I think.
Yes, I had just started when you came in.
Yeah.
Let's go. So did you know about all this background
no.
before you?
No, this time actually I just finished it yesterday, the book. So okay. I didn't have time to even, I think I've read Benjamin Button. That's the only work I think I've read, the only short story. So I was not very familiar. I didn't know it was based on his life. So the presentation has been really fun this time. It was, I didn't know much of it.
Yeah,
so pretty interesting, and I still have to watch the movie. And there are lots of movies apparently.
There's one with
Robert Redford. So yes. I think they'll both be interesting, at least those two.
Yeah, I watched the recent one, so I think Percy might have a better idea about the movies. You're there, Percy? Oh, haven't seen the older ones. Okay. I felt a little bit they had changed the story in the recent one, but otherwise mostly they have did see the DiCaprio one. Yeah, same here. I also saw the DiCaprio one. In fact, I saw the movie only today, didn't get time before that, but yes, they haven't. I think they show Nick as a writer, and not much of changes otherwise. I think they've stuck true to the story as far as possible. I also got the chance to read a graphic novel of The Great Gatsby, and that was also a fun experience. Nice to picturize and visualize the whole story. So I'll proceed with the discussion points, and then maybe we'll come back. After some two discussion points, maybe I'll come back. Okay. So the first topic I wanted to talk about was betrayal. I think that was the strongest theme of the novel. And it looks like on first reading, it looks like as if it's just an unfortunate sequence of events which leads to Gatsby's death. But, as I feel a little more deeper reading, when I read, maybe I read in this order. First, I read the graphic novel, then I read the actual book, then I watched the movie. And with the graphic novel, it didn't really hit as much. It felt like just a sequence of events. But then when I was reading the actual book and the movie, I think I could really feel the effect of how he's been betrayed by both Daisy and by Tom. So Daisy is completely smitten with him, and she's so happy to leave Tom and get back to this loving Gatsby, as long as she knew that Gatsby is rich. But once Tom, reveals that this is how he has become rich, he's this new rich person, he's not an established family, and he's this bootlegger who's with unlawful activities and all these things. Once she hears that, she actually stops herself. She thinks again. And after that, she doesn't care that he's dead. Even that doesn't seem to move her. She doesn't even attend his funeral. And with Tom, again, it's a clear case of betrayal. So Tom, clearly, he has shown that it's he is the one who tells that it's Gatsby's car, though he doesn't actually tell in words that Gatsby is the one who's who hit, you know, Myrtle. But he just reveals that it's his car. I didn't drive the car. I was driving the blue one and all that. So again, another thing is he feeds and he entertains the entire city, but not one single person turns up for his, you know, funeral. So it's a case of betrayal again and again. Second thing is that the word green, you know, the color green, it appears, you know, what does it signify over here? In fact, it appears again and again. So green indicates over here Shakespeare's green-eyed monster. Does anyone know what's Shakespeare's green-eyed monster? Maybe you can unmute yourself and tell. Someone? Shakespeare's green-eyed monster. I'm very sure you all know. Yeah, reference to Othello. So, but what does it mean, Percy? I'm very, I'm surprised you all are silent. Yeah, is it the person? Yes, a personification of jealousy. So, green-eyed monster is jealousy, of course.
Apparently, yeah, green-eyed monster is jealousy. Green indicates.
I think you need to mute yourself. Okay. So, green indicates Shakespeare's green-eyed monster. Yeah, jealousy. So, in fact, the word green appears 14 times in the novel. And most of the indications are with Gatsby himself. So one, I just thought I'll just pick out a few of the things. So instances of jealousy. So one is the green light. So every time he sees that, he feels it's something, you know, somewhere far away, she's there. It's a yearning and he's jealous and all those things. So again, Wilson, he says in the sunlight, his face was green. So once Wilson finds out that, Myrtle is having an affair with somebody else, she's carrying on with someone else, immediately, you know, the jealousy that he feels becomes physical, it becomes a physical ailment. And in the sunlight, his face was green, you know, they say that. So there are instances of jealousy, which is shown by Tom, Daisy, Gatsby, Wilson, and Myrtle. In fact, Gatsby, when he says, "You loved me too," so that exchange of conversation, I don't remember. I don't know if you remember that. I found it extremely interesting how Tom confronts Gatsby, and then Gatsby says, "You know, just tell him that no, we both are in love with each other, and you're going to come away with me." And he tries to prove to Tom that Daisy never loved Tom, and it's always been Gatsby that she loved. And when Daisy in fact tells that no, you know, I loved you too, even when I loved Tom, so when he says that loved me too, how can you even say that? And again, the Myrtle, when she sees from above the window at the car, and she sees the yellow car where Tom sits, and next to Tom is Jordan Baker, and she thinks that Jordan, she assumes Jordan is the wife. She assumes that that must be Daisy. So there's so much of, you know, jealousy in her eyes when she looks at her. And that's when Nick says there's no confusion like the confusion of a simple mind. So all these were the instances of jealousy in the book. Then comes, okay. So this was another interesting thing. So why did the author choose Nick as the narrator? What do you think? Maybe any of you would like to unmute and say your thoughts on this. Why do you think the author chose Nick as the narrator? Tulika or Shamal Rao ji, do you want to give it a shot?
Okay, I'm not sure. I think maybe, again, at that time, I think a lot of novels were written, were told from the perspective of somebody else. Like they never wrote, they rarely wrote a novel in novel form. Either they were written as letters or they were written as somebody narrating. So maybe an outside person who doesn't know Gatsby and slowly gets to know him. I don't know. I'm just...
I agree with this. You know, even I was thinking about this even with Wuthering Heights also. It's a completely unknown, a tenant, no part of the family who actually comes in and, you know, narrates the story. So I think that is something maybe they felt that that makes the entire, you know, narration more interesting and maybe a little bit removed from the conversation could be.
I felt it that way actually. Almost makes it an outsider in this sense. So an outsider can have an objective, whatever that is, the view of the story like that. That is why he has been chosen.
Correct. Anybody else? Correct. Anybody else might even be an untrustable person in this particular scenario, I guess. We don't know whether they are giving us the correct picture, but Nick, maybe we can trust Nick's words. Also, one other interesting thing which I saw was that I read an article which said that Nick's character is a complete contrast to Gatsby's character. And this could be something that the author wanted to highlight. For example, Gatsby is this, you know, bootlegger. He's considered this dishonest person and all that. But on the other hand, Nick says that though it's something that he congratulates himself for, he says that I think I'm the most honest person who's there. And Gatsby has this, you know, imaginative, a very innocent, trusting quality. He's always dreamy and hopeful for the future. But Nick, he's this person, hard person of reason, experience. He's grounded in reality and practicality. In fact, even when his 30th birthday, he says it's like, you know, it's my birthday. And then he says, I'm turning 30. I'm just looking forward to a decade of loneliness. I'm just going to be alone for the next 10 years. So even this conversation between them, you know, where Nick says you can't repeat the past, you know, Gatsby says that he wants to now once again live with Daisy, bring her here, maybe get married to her once again, you know, just turn back. So Nick says you can't repeat the past, but Gatsby says can't repeat the past. Why? Of course you can. So I think that shows that contrast between them. And that could also be one of the reasons why, you know, like what you, he's an outsider and a great contrast to what Gatsby is.
Also the way they work, Nick isn't some kind of a very, how should I put it? A very regular kind of job. He doesn't want, even when Gatsby offers him a job, he says, I don't want that. I'm happy with my own bond. He's sitting in office all day and he's traveling for work. He's just work, home kind of person. Whereas this guy is this big party, flamboyant. So there's the contrast is very stark between the two of them.
Correct. But somehow, I don't know, maybe it's my feeling, but I felt that though Nick, you know, he is this regular kind of a person, but I think he has a yearning and a love for that partying culture. But Gatsby, though he's in the midst of it and he's the one who's throwing these parties, he seems to withdraw himself
Gatsby kind of fascinates Nick, I feel, because even before he is invited to the party, he's looking, he's watching what's happening, and he likes all the hubbub. So and he ends up caring for him a lot. That was very interesting. How like there's nobody and he's desperately wanting somebody to come to the funeral. That's very touching. Yeah.
Very touching. Very, very touching. Also, okay. So this was one more thing. It's a lot debated upon. I'm not sure. So one of the things which they speak about is the accident. Was this on purpose? A lot of essays and articles written about it. Did Daisy purposely run over Myrtle? I don't know. I would love to hear your opinion on it. If you have any thoughts on that, did it ever cross your mind that it could be a purposeful thing when you read it?
Not mine. It was it said that she was running towards, Myrtle was running towards the car because she thought Tom was driving it, and Tom, her husband was restraining her. So
yeah,
I don't know. It didn't strike me at all that Daisy might have. Had Daisy met Myrtle ever?
Yeah, they don't show anything, you know. They don't reveal it. Yeah, she know, or would she know? I don't know.
How would she know? Then why would she? If she didn't know her, why would she run over a random? I don't know. That's what I thought. So
even I didn't think about it a lot. I think there's someone on chat. Okay. I don't think the accident is premeditated. Did they meet in the movie? No, they did not meet in the movie to Percy. No, they did not meet. Mm. Yeah. And in fact, even when, Gatsby claims that for the last 5 years, she's been in love with me. You know, that's what he says of Daisy. So immediately he says, you know, then how is that even possible? Did you come and deliver vegetables through the back door? Only then that's possible that you would have met Daisy. So that much of a control he had over Daisy's movements, you know. So I don't think there was a chance that they met, but she could have known. Even I didn't think about it when I read, but there are a lot written about, this particular line which I've mentioned over here. There's a lot of analysis which has gone behind it. So there was an unmistakable air of natural intimacy about the picture. This was when Nick sees, Gatsby is waiting down to make sure that Tom doesn't do something to Daisy after the accident. And so Nick just hides and goes and has a peep inside what they both are doing. And they are both just holding hands and sitting and talking to each other, you know. So he says there's this unmistakable air of natural intimacy about the picture, and that they were conspiring together. So there's a lot of, I just read many articles where they say that maybe she knew about it, she could have braked, she could have tried stopping, maybe at that moment it was favorable turn of events for her that she came in between and then she just ran her over and she didn't stop. So we don't know. I also didn't feel, just like what you all said, even I didn't feel that it could be done purposely, but I just read some interesting articles about that. So
also one more thing, where Daisy is coming from a very terrible scene, you know, there's been this big fight between Gatsby and Tom. So again, to think that she could have planned, and she was in a very disturbed state of mind. So it seems more logical that she was not driving carefully and the accident was an accident.
Correct.
Maybe this, I don't know, this line.
And this conspiring together could also mean they conspired what to do next together.
Correct. Absolutely. Yeah. Mm.
Now she must have confessed that, she could have confessed that it was me who ran over her. And, then they might have planned, okay, let's get away. That, because that's what they end up doing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, okay. So after this, I just have a, Fitzgerald wasn't very popular, but most of the writers in his in the Lost Generation group, in fact, adored his writing. Many of them felt that Great Gatsby has been a huge improvement over the previous novels that he had written. So, in fact, Gertrude Stein says, Fitzgerald will be read when many of his well-known contemporaries would be forgotten. Another thing was there is this letter which T.S. Eliot writes to Fitzgerald, and this is posted through the publishing house, and he says in that, when I have time, I should like to write to you more fully and tell you exactly why it seems to me such a remarkable book. He's talking about The Great Gatsby. In fact, it seems to me to be the first step that American fiction has taken since Henry James. Her voice is full of money, Gatsby says to Nick. Do you remember this scene when he says this? this is when you know I think it is Nick who's saying her voice reminds me of something and all that, and then you know Gatsby says her voice is full of money. I don't know, somehow I felt these words were so significant and such an interesting way to put it, you know, a person's voice is full of money. And a lot of such very interesting metaphors are filled in the book. You may fool me, but can't fool God, Wilson says to Myrtle, and he points to those glasses. I don't know that. Yeah. Do you remember that, Shyamal Rao ji?
Yes, I remember actually.
Yeah.
There is a big billboard actually.
Yeah.
And there are two expected lenses actually. That has mounted and other things actually. So people will be feeling that they feel that it is a symbolic of God, and God is getting, is observing these activities through that.
Correct. I actually read a very interesting story about this. Again, I'm not sure how far it's true. Can't trust everything you read online. But I read that there was this very ugly cover made for this book, The Great Gatsby, which was the first cover which was designed for the book. And at that time, Fitzgerald hadn't written about this billboard. This billboard was not there in the book at all. So when that cover had these huge eyes on it, which was supposed to depict Daisy's eyes. And what did you say?
Yes.
Have you read about this, about this incident, Shyamal Rao ji?
That's actually, I didn't come across that, madam.
Okay. So it said that after he saw that, he got the inspiration to write about a particular, you know, symbolism with these eyes. And and then he went and changed the manuscript and fitted this billboard and the eyes and made it symbolic.
yes.
Just interesting, I think, anecdotes from the period.
Correct.
So again, the opening line was also something really significant, I felt. So whenever you feel like criticizing anyone, he told me, which is Nick's father who's saying that, you know, that just remember that all the people in this world haven't had the advantages that you've had. This felt like, you know, Fitzgerald telling, justifying himself, maybe, you know. He wants to say that, you know, I haven't had all the advantages that you've had. So you can't criticize me for whatever I am. There's a comment. It's a superb line because you can totally imagine someone sounding like money. Exactly, you know, Percy, when I read that line, I was absolutely blown away. It's so simple, but yes, someone who has money does sound so different from someone who doesn't have it. And again, this was also a very interesting thing. I'm one of the few honest people that I have ever known. So Nick says that, and somehow I felt like I could trust Nick. Yeah, he's saying what he's saying is right. Yeah, definitely he's an honest person. You know? It didn't feel such a bloated statement to make about oneself. Yeah, it's a great opening line too, made me think a lot. I try to keep it in mind as much as I can. Yeah. So with that, we are at the end of it. So I must say that I had a very interesting read of the MA English IGNOW study material, and it was absolutely amazing. Somewhere 5 detailed chapters on The Great Gatsby. And it's, in case if you can get your hands on it, do try to, you know, get it. It's all available online. It's, there's no charges. It's actually all the study material available free. Anyone can pick it up and read. They've also analyzed Great Gatsby based on the Vedic principles of Dharma and Artha and all those things also. Even that was interesting. The couple of paragraphs on that, I didn't include it because I didn't want it to make it sound very dense. I thought maybe it would get too dense, so I didn't. So it's interesting. It talks about how there's a lot of emphasis placed on pleasure and, you know, self-gratification and selfishness and all these things, while dharma is missing. And this is one of the reasons why finally at the end of the day, you know, all the people in the novel get, you know, whatever they have gotten. So though Gatsby is the one who suffered a lot, but it's not like Daisy or Tom could also, I'm not sure how far they will be able to, you know, resume their life where they left it. It's definitely going to be a huge, you know, barrier to their peaceful existence. I think so. I don't know. Let me just read a few of your comments. Yes. Okay. So Tulika says, Nick doesn't sound conceited, just honest. Exactly, Tulika. That's what I felt. You know, if anyone else made such a statement, any other character, I would really be like, what is this? What are they trying to say? But with Nick, it felt natural. It felt true. Yeah, he is honest. And yeah. So Percy has shared a link. Oh, great. So Percy has done a write-up on the film and how I felt it compared to the novel. Fantastic. Great. Thank you so much for sharing this, Percy. I just wish I had read this before I made the presentation. I'm sure this will be having a lot more of your, lot more gems than what I've done. I'll also read it for sure.
Okay. Tell me one thing. Yes. Daisy come to know that this person has been shot? Sorry, Gatsby, ever?
It looks, I'm not very sure, but in the movie, she definitely comes to know.
Ah, because in the novel, we don't get to know whether she knows. As in, I kept wondering whether I should root for Daisy and Gatsby. Who should I be rooting for? It was just not clear throughout the... I wanted to root for them though, because when they meet after all those many years, they're very happy and even she's happy. But somehow, I don't know. I think it was very rushed, no? I don't know whether anybody of you felt like that. The end, I found it very... Everything happened so quickly and even she doesn't have time. See, if she's saying, I loved you 5 years back, and then somebody suddenly says that he's this dishonest person. So it's not natural for her to slow down, right? It's not like she... And it's okay also for her to have been for a little time in love with Tom after when they were married. And
exactly.
So, so I got on it. But after it was so quick, no, everything.
Yeah, it looks like, see, it's actually only a matter of a day, right? One day alone. He goes home, he drops her. He's waiting for her to make sure that, you know, Tom doesn't do anything to her. Hmm. And he does nothing. So he comes home and then he and, you know, Nick have this huge discussion in the morning. Then Nick goes off for his work. Correct. But Nick is still obsessing about what's happening back there at home. He goes for a swim. He gets shot. That's all. So I think it quickly gets over because of that.
That's right. I kept wondering what Daisy was thinking, what she thought about this whole thing. Was she okay with him dying and her being saved from the... baggage of, you know, having killed somebody or did she feel sorry? I wish she had clarified that. Yeah, Percy's saying something.
But I think definitely she, even in the novel, though it's not explicitly stated, considering that Gatsby was so popular and considering that, you know, media was around and everyone, there's photographs taken, it's appearing in the newspapers, Daisy couldn't have missed it. She couldn't have missed knowing that Gatsby has been shot, right? Has been shot by Wilson. So that also couldn't have, she couldn't have missed because Wilson himself commits suicide over there. That's also covered in the papers. So I feel it's just, you know, a kind of callous attitude, completely careless.
This is what was my point of worry. Does she also not care for Gatsby because of that money angle? That kind of rankled a lot with me. That old money, new money thing. I know Tom had that for sure.
Definitely.
But Daisy M is, would, given the chance, would she have taken over? I don't, there's some comments, Archana.
Yeah. I'll read the comments. Yeah. So I think Scott wants you to see Gatsby and Daisy as flawed characters shaped by their social status, which the way he saw it could not end otherwise than in tragedy.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, true. That's definitely, you know, right. And Okay, Shamil Rauji says there are few paras in the book that are lyrical. I gathered John Keats was his favorite poet and his imagination was fired to life by Keats. Okay, maybe he could not write poetry like Keats, but he succeeded when he took the spirit of Keats and infused it into a different form, that of the lyrical novel. Definitely, it did sound, you know, like poetry in certain places, the descriptions and the metaphors, definitely. Yes, I do think Nick Fitzgerald are hinting to us that Daisy too is eventually a child of her upbringing. And yeah, I think the ending is supposed to show she's got the callousness of a class. Yeah, even I felt that, Tulika, you know, I felt that she's got this non-caring attitude. In fact, I didn't go more in depth of Zelda and, you know, Zelda and Fitzgerald's relationship. There's so much more. If you just Google it, you can, you know, learn about it. Zelda is also this equally callous person. You know, she hurts Fitzgerald like anything. And he also does that back to her. So, in fact, so much of Daisy is reflected in his own wife, Fitzgerald's actual wife. And it's quite surprising, quite shocking, the way, you know, she manipulates him, the way he manipulates her. He used to carry a gun in his pocket and keep threatening every time that I'm going to shoot myself. He has climbed on windows, Fitzgerald, and threatened that I'm going to jump. They are these kind of, they also are these kind of careless people who don't bother about, you know, anything or anyone around. I think he realizes that he is such a person, and he's brought it out very well, criticizing himself. It's a criticism of himself and his wife, and you know, their relationship, that he's been successfully bring it out in a novel.
I should read up about them. To be able to see your own failings and to write it down for everybody to see, because people who knew him would have figured that he's writing about himself. That's exactly really brave, I think.
Zelda herself would have known when she read it, oh my God, he's writing about me.
Yeah, that's something.
Yeah. In fact, Zelda has also published one book. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So that's also very interesting. In fact, you know, there is this one scene where Nick is in the, Tom takes Nick, and they have this huge party where he takes Myrtle around, and I think Catherine is her sister. She also shows up, and they do all that.
Towards
the end, you know, there's this scene where Nick stands at the window and he looks out and he sees there are so many windows around, and every window actually has a story. Mm. You know, everywhere there's something happening. And then he feels that he is also an onlooker. Though he's living the life, he's also as an onlooker from outside looking at himself. I think that's exactly what Fitzgerald has been, you know, trying to do. He was living it and also staying out and looking at himself and writing, you know, which is quite a great thing to do. Shamil Rauji says he gives a specimen of the lyrical nature of the thing and of the novel. A wafer of a moon was shining over Gatsby's house, making the night fine as before and surviving the laughter and the sound of his still glowing garden. A sudden emptiness seemed to flow now from the windows and the great doors, endowing with complete isolation the figure of the host who stood on his porch, his hand up in a formal gesture of farewell. Yeah, such a beautiful sentence. They were careless people, Tom and Daisy. They smashed up things and creatures and then retreated back into their money or their vast carelessness or whatever it was that kept them together and let other people clean up the mess they had made. This is the important line. Definitely. It comes, Nick says that. Yes, that clarifies it. Correct. I think this book has been such a wonderful picture of society at that point of time, the jazz age, you know, as he calls, because after this was the 30s and the Great Depression struck. And it was all, I think, I'm not sure if ever America went back into this kind of a, you know, completely money oriented, mad, crazy culture had died down with the 20s. I think it never went back to as crazy as what it was then. I think so. I'm not very sure. I haven't read completely about the history, but it's a very, very interesting depiction of the 20s. Anyone wants to add anything else, please feel free to unmute yourself. Okay, so should I wrap it up? Shamal Rao ji, do you want to add anything else?
It's okay, ma'am. We can close.
Okay. Okay, Tulika, you want to add something?
No, go ahead.
Okay, thank you so much for coming. I know tomorrow is a working day and I've kept you up late on a Thursday. Thank you so much for joining in. And we are yet to choose the next novel. So I'll put up a post tomorrow and we'll choose the book for August.
Let's do an Indian one in honor of 15th August.
Wow, that's a great idea. Tulika, please drop in any suggestions you have. Just message me. Yeah. And Great Gatsby was actually Tulika's suggestion. Thank you so much for making me read it.
I wanted to read it for a long time. I hadn't read it. And then I put it off so long that I like Monday, I was like, I haven't read it on Thursday. So, but
yes.
It's good.
Very true. Same, you know, it's the same thing with me. So I've been wanting to read it. But of course, you know, with the book club, I think I also end up reading it, and I end up reading it so deeply in so many versions. And
yeah, right. That's the fun part.
I really love it. Yeah, I love what I'm doing. And I know I'll never do it if not for all of y'all. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shamal Rao ji. Thanks, Percy. Thanks for joining in. Bye, everybody.